What if I told you that Ethereum's biggest problem isn't speed or cost, it's sovereignty? This video is my quick review based on my understanding of a very detailed and technical discussion I had with Michael Sutton earlier this week, the co-author of vProgs, and why I think vProgs' approach to sovereignty will fundamentally change how we think about blockchain scalability. So, let's quickly define the problem. Here is the issue with current L2s on Ethereum. Like Base, Optimism, Arbitrum, they trap you in two-dimensional bundles.
Because if you have a two-dimensional space where apps are within a roll-up entity like Base, Arbitrum, and others like Ethereum, if you're an app, you benefiting from the fact you can compose with different entities, with different other contracts, a newer specific rollup. And you actually, I don't know, you loan against some kind, or you provide liquidity from your token to some swapping service or some DEX. Then if you would want to compose with a different app sitting on Arbitrum, you'd have to move your app to that place and make sure you have the same kind of services and liquidity. You're kind of tied to this bundle. So the two dimensions create an unsound space where you're not free to, it's not a zero-sum game, or it's not a healthy competition between applications, but applications have these constraints that come from the fact that they're part of another bundle, and the liquidity doesn't necessarily move easily between two roll-up entities.
Your favorite app is stuck executing everyone else's transaction. Your state size depends on others, and you are suffering from the noisy neighbor problem, and it's killing unified liquidity.
If you read Yonatan already, like, he has a blog post from 2020 about the Ethereum supernova and the fragmentation problem within Ethereum, and how he was thinking that might be unsolvable because Ethereum reached this fragmented state. It cannot even, whatever effort you do, there's too much interest already, and you cannot redesign the system and fix it. So he wanted to do it correctly on Kaspa from the set out.
Think about it. If you want to compose with an app on a different L2, you have to bridge, you have to move liquidity, and then hope that same service exists there. This is not healthy competition. It's an artificial constraint. Now, let's see how vProgs plans to solve this or handle this. vProgs are trying to solve this by creating three different types of sovereignty. So, execution time sovereignty, state size sovereignty, and third, proving sovereignty. Let's quickly go through each of them. Execution time sovereignty. Basically, you only need to compute your own transactions, not everyone else's transaction, so no more noisy neighbors. Second, state size sovereignty. Your storage requirements don't depend on other programs. Third, the proving sovereignty. You can prove your program's validity without waiting for or depending on others to prove first, or others to prove their first. But here's the magic. vProgs achieve this sovereignty without sacrificing composability. It's a huge thing, and that's the true breakthrough, guys, that vProgs still manage to achieve the sovereignty without sacrificing composability. You know, traditional blockchains force you to choose. Either you have to choose the siloed and sovereign approach, or you are composable, but then traps you in a shared execution environment. Let me try to say it again. Traditional blockchains force you to choose. Either you're siloed and sovereign, or you're composable, but then traps you in a shared execution environment. Hope it's getting clearer to you what vProgs are. As Michael explains in the video, it's all about single sequencer architecture.
But if you think about it, we do have one canonical order. So, and that's very powerful, because if we have one canonical order, we actually have one consensus for the entire global state, even if it's fragmented, even if it's siloed, there's every point in time, you can like point a, attribute a point in time to each transaction, right? So for every point in time, we actually have a deterministic, a well-defined state of the entire L2 space. And that attribute can be used to conceptually create scene composability, because if there's a degreed state while executing a transaction, it's very clear deterministically what's the state of all others. You can actually imagine a design which uses this to actually read from multiple places and actually compose a logic.
Because Kaspa layer 1 sequences everything with canonical ordering, there is a deterministic global state every point in time. This means programs can synchronously compose reading and writing to each other atomically while still remaining sovereign entities. The program owner decides the business model. They choose the proving frequency and control the computational resources. It's sovereignty of the service provider, as Michael puts it. You just need 1% of the hash rate to maintain sovereignty. That's the power of Kaspa 100 blocks per second vision. But sovereignty does mean obligation. If you have a stake in the program, you maintain it, you keep it live, you ensure it progresses. But other entities cannot hold you hostage. That's what true decentralization is. So here is the kicker. This is more than just a technical architecture. It's about creating one-dimensional liquidity space where programs compete fairly without artificial constraints. It's about unified liquidity through asset hubs that every program can compose with. It's about fixing what Michael calls it Ethereum's unsolvable fragmentation problem. vProgs, for me, represent a fundamental rethinking of L2 design in a way that mimics L1 experience with L2 scalability.
The intention here is that L1 remains the hub of vProgs. You deploy them on L1, obviously execute them not on L1, but because they're atomically and synchronously composable, the experience should be as if they are an L1. That's like the user experience and the dev experience. The aim is that it should be like this unified space. And in that sense, you want to say they are L1. They are very native. Like L1 is doing a whole lot of effort to maintaining information so that they compose. Okay, so the fact that L1 technically isn't executing, it's still doing so much to create this unified one-dimensional space where everyone can interact with each other. So hopefully it creates the feeling of an L1.
Guys, if you haven't watched already, please do consider watching our 90-minute session. I think it'll be very helpful for you.